hand grenade?
Yes, of course! The holy hand grenade of Antioch. It is one of the sacred relics Brother Maynard carries with him. Brother Maynard, bring up the holy hand grenade.
How does it work?
I know not, my liege.
Consult the Book of Armaments.
Armaments, chapter 2, verses 9 to 21.
And Saint Attila raised the hand grenade up on high, saying, O Lord, bless this thy hand grenade, that with it thou mayst blow thy enemies to tiny bits in thy mercy. And the Lord did grin, and the people did feast upon the lambs, and sloths, and carp, and anchovies, and orangutans, and breakfast cereals, and fruit bats, and large...
Skip a bit, brother.
And the Lord spake, saying, First shalt thou take out the holy pin, then shalt thou count to three, no more, no less. Three shall be the number thou shalt count, and the number of the counting shall be three. Four shalt thou not count, neither count thou two, excepting that thou then proceed to three. Five is right out. Once the number three, being the third number, be reached, then lobbest thou thy holy hand grenade at Antioch towards thy foe, who, being not in my sight, shall snuff it.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Right. One, two, five!
Three's up!
Three!
Hey everybody, Carolina Gun Guy here. Now for those of you that don't know, there is no Book of Armaments in the Bible. This was just the invention of a group of extremely talented individuals and portrayed in the movie Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Obviously, given that the Bible was written well before the invention of gunpowder and guns, there's also no mention of guns in the Bible. So, thanks for watching. Hope you had a good... No, I'm just kidding. You know, there's several verses in the Bible that do discuss weapons, the need for self-defense, vengeance, things like that. So I want to go over some of that today. Before I do, please hit that subscribe button if you haven't already. I do occasional giveaways and have another one coming up when I hit 1,000 subscribers. So hit the thumbs up if you find anything interesting, and thanks for watching. One of the most commonly quoted verses when it comes to the need for a weapon is in the book of Luke. Jesus was warning his disciples of coming dangers. He was sending them out into the world to spread the gospel, and he knew that the disciples would face opposition to this. Luke 22:36 says, He said to them, But now let the one who has a money bag take it, and likewise a knapsack, and let the one who has no sword sell his cloak and buy one. So not only does Jesus say that you need a sword, but it's more important than even having a cloak, which is more of a protective outer garment worn over your other clothes. Often not mentioned is just two verses later in Luke 22:38, where it says right there, And they said, Look, Lord, here are two swords. And he said to them, It is enough. If I asked you to whittle your guns down to two, you'd want, I don't know, an AR-15, maybe two of them. You'd want a good defensive pistol for carry purposes. You'd want a .22 for small game or practice or just for fun. You'd want a shotgun for home defense. You'd want an AR-10 or an AK-47 or an AR-9 or a Kel-Tec something just for fun. It would be very difficult just to whittle your guns down to which two you should keep or buy, but these verses clearly indicate that the purpose of having a sword was self-defense, and it was not only acceptable but recommended that the disciples have a sword on them. There are a few verses in the Bible that deal specifically with self-defense, including another one in the same book of Luke, Luke 11:21-22, where it says, When a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace, his goods are safe. But when one stronger than he attacks him and overcomes him, he takes away his armor in which he has trusted and divides his spoil. This same sentiment is echoed earlier in Matthew 12:29. right there, where it says, "Or how can someone enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man? Then indeed he may plunder his house." So these two verses are completely removed from the context around it, which deals with Jesus casting out demons and not placing your faith in the wrong place. But there is a theme here regarding defending your palace, your home. Whoever is better armed will win the struggle. Now, going all the way back to the Old Testament, we have another verse about self-defense and the morality involved in defending yourself. For those of you who may not know, the Old Testament deals with the original creation of the earth, the fall of man, God giving laws for man to follow, man's struggle to stay close to God while keeping those laws, and with the constant rebellion and repentance in cyclical fashion. So God gave the law to Moses in Exodus, and Exodus 22:2 says, "If a thief is found breaking in and is struck so that he dies, there shall be no blood guilt for him." Blood guilt simply being guilty of shedding blood or committing murder. So it was clear even from the beginning when God gave the law to Moses and the Israelites, thievery was not to be condoned and defense of both yourself and your property were acceptable. Why do I say both yourself and property? Well, it refers to the bad guy here as a thief, not a murderer. So if a thief breaks in, presumably to commit theft, and you defend against him and kill him, there is no guilt there. The book of Nehemiah deals partly with Nehemiah's return to Jerusalem and him overseeing the reconstruction of the walls of Jerusalem, which had been destroyed in earlier conquest. Jerusalem's enemies did not want the walls rebuilt, so there was concern of attack during this time. Nehemiah 4:16-18 says, "From that day on, half of my servants worked on construction, and half held the spears, shields, bows, and coats of mail. And the leaders stood behind the whole house of Judah who were building the wall. Those who carried burdens were loaded in such a way that each labored on the work with one hand and held his weapon with the other. And each of the builders had his sword strapped at his side while he built. The man who sounded the trumpet was beside me." Now this gives testament to being prepared for the need to defend oneself, and that the manner in which you do so can be with a weapon. A sword was the equivalent of a gun during this time, in that it was the most effective personal defense weapon available during the day. The events here took place in the mid-5th century BC. Had guns been invented by this time, the verse may have said that each builder had his Smith & Wesson S&W 500 strapped at his side, or his Glock 19X if you're a Glock fanboy. But a sword was available, and while keeping watch and being cognizant for the potential need for self-defense, it was the best method of doing so by keeping your sword nearby. Now there's another verse in Joel that I'll just briefly mention. Joel 3, chapter 3, verse 10. Find it here. "Beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am a warrior." This chapter of Joel dealt with the coming judgment of God's enemies, and again just mentions the need to arm yourself for battle and be aware of that. Now, after all the self-defense and method of arms verses we've talked about so far, we're going to pivot to some verses specifically that caution against seeking vengeance, retribution, or violence. There's nothing we've discussed so far that says you cannot defend yourself, but there's a limit to what you can or should do. Proverbs 20:22, right up top here, says, "Do not say, I will repay evil. Wait for the Lord, and he will deliver you." Similarly, in Romans 12:19 says, where is it? Got it. It says, "Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord." You know, self-defense is one thing, but seeking retribution yourself for someone else's evil actions is specifically condemned in these verses. If everyone followed these verses, we wouldn't have the Rambo franchise or Taken movies or the John Wick movies, which I haven't seen myself, but I hear they're rooted in revenge. So we're specifically told to let God provide his version of justice, which, while may not be satisfying to our earthly desires, it will be just and fair in the grand scheme of things. A verse that is often quoted by pacifists or people who want to prove that the Bible contradicts itself is the following, Matthew 5:39. "But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil, but if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. Now, this doesn't mean that you can't defend yourself. This clearly isn't talking about laying down and surrender if someone is trying to do you bodily harm. That's not what the context of this passage deals with. In fact, you can see the heading of the passage right there, retaliation. Not just here in the ESV version, but in other versions, it mentions that this is a warning against retaliation. This deals more with retribution after an action. Like if someone cuts off your arm, you shouldn't seek him or her out to cut their arm off in revenge. Self-defense and revenge are completely different concepts and are not to be confused or mangled together. The last verse I'm going to discuss is Matthew 26:52. Then Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword." This would seem at first to be a cautionary tale that if you have a sword or a gun and are willing to use it, then you will die by such. But the specific context in which this verse is used is when a disciple, Peter, drew his sword in swift anger and cut off the ear of a servant of a high priest when they had come to arrest Jesus. This again was a rebuke against retaliation and revengeance, and also a quiet rebuke to Peter for his rashness and his willingness to get revenge when they had come to arrest Jesus, not do harm to him. There was no physical attack against Peter that he was defending. He immediately went to violence to retaliate. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope this was insightful in a little bit of a way. I appreciate you guys watching. Don't forget to subscribe, and God bless you.